Now we're ready for the punchline for this section, which is the definition of a derivative. So we've talked about average rates of change and instantaneous rates of change for a bunch of examples. Now let's talk about a general function. There's a pretty general function, y equals f of x. And what we care about is what is the rate of change with respect to x at a. In other words, if we increase x a tiny bit, how much does y change? What is the conversion factor between changes in x and changes in y? And the way we do this is we take a value of x that's nearby, and we look at the value here. Here's f of x, and here's f of a. Okay, I can't draw worth a damn, but there it goes. Now, we usually have names for these differences. The amount that we went up, that is the amount that f of x changed, we call that delta f. Or sometimes we call that delta y because it's the amount that y changed. After all, y is f of x. The amount that we went sideways, we call that delta x. And if you want the average rate of change, ROC is rate of change, that's going to be delta f over delta x. Delta f is f of x minus f of a, and delta x is x minus a. And if you like drawing pictures, that's the slope of a line between these two points. You can draw a line between those two points, and that's a secant line, and the slope of that secant line is this ratio. But the instantaneous rate of change is the limit as we take x closer and closer and closer and closer to a of that ratio. And that's not going to be the slope of the secant line. That's going to be the slope of the tangent line. More importantly, it's the instantaneous rate of change, and we give it a special name. We call it the derivative of the function f of x. And we often write it as f prime of a. There are a lot of other notations. It's sometimes written as df dx, or, well, that's the most common notation, sometimes d sub x of f. Lots of notations. For now, let's just stick with f prime of a. Okay. So the idea is that f prime of a is the limit as x approaches a of f of x minus f of a over x minus a. That's important. We'll put a box around it. Now, another useful bit of notation is to define this quantity h. H is x minus a, which is also delta x. Well, if h is x minus a, then x is a plus h. So when we write f of x minus a minus f of a, we could write it as f of a plus h minus f of a. And a plus h minus a is just h. So this limit is the same thing as this limit. F of a plus h, that's f of x. F of a, that's f of a. H, that's x minus a. So sometimes it's convenient to do the limits in this form. Sometimes it's more convenient to do the limit in this form, and they mean the exact same thing. Both of these expressions are the derivative of the function f of x at x equals a. Finally, I'd like to rework an old problem in terms of h. We did it in terms of x going to a, or actually t going to a, t going to 2. Our old problem is here's a function, s of t is 4t squared plus 3, and we want to know what is s prime of 2. What is the rate of change at time 2? In other words, what's the speed of our particle? Or if you prefer, what's the slope of the tangent line? So it's the limit as h goes to 0 of s of 2 plus h minus s of 2 over h. And then we just say, oh, S of 2 plus h is 4, 2 plus h squared plus 3. And S of 2 is 19 divided by h. And then we expand it out. 2 plus h squared is 4 plus 4h plus h squared. Then plus 3 minus 19 is minus 16. And 4 times 4 equals 16, so those cancel. And we're left with 16h plus 4h squared over h. Well, that cancels. This h and this squared cancel against that h. And you're left with the limit of 16 plus 4h as h goes to 0. And just as before, the answer is 16. So you can work your limits in terms of as t goes to 2, or you can work your limits as h goes to 0. It gives the same answer either way. It's totally equivalent.